to prepare for today's lesson, I thought about the needs of the kids. I thought about what the kids would enjoy doing, but more importantly, I thought of a concept that the kids typically struggle with. Graphing is always one where they would struggle, just with the concept, but then, and when you throw in real world experiences, then it really gets kind of a little crazy from. So today we did something a little different. The real world experience I thought about for them was something that they actually have played and done. So we threw in some Angry Birds with quadratics. And it was great to see the kids really, you know, they were playing the game, but as they were playing the game, they were still able to adapt the concepts that they learned about quadratics. Okay, good morning, guys. So today we're going to be, we'll continue to explore quadratics, but today we're going to do something a little bit different. We're going to actually connect quadratics to real world situations, and I think you may actually like the real world situation, but before we can do that, we need to refresh on some of the vocabulary that we've been working on. And the vocabulary refresher is in the form of a crossword puzzle. Flip it over and get started, and you can work with your neighbors. Those of you who are sitting on the end will get you a clipboard. All right, I'm gonna turn the lights down a little low for you so that you can actually see the word bank. Now listen, you have how many clues? How many clues are on your paper? Is it six clues? It's seven clues. How many words do I have on the board? How many words do I have on the board? Okay, so I have eight words on the board. There's only seven clues. So are you going to use all the eight words? All right, ladies and gentlemen, I have my first group who's done with the first activity. So we're now going to check the answers. And it doesn't mean that they're right. Did anybody else finish? How many more did you have?
Three.
You had two, you had four. And how many more did you guys have?
One.
All right. Check your answers, check your answers. I'll collect them in a second, but check your answers. The answers are over here on the side. How many of you said that one across was axis of symmetry? Awesome sauce. One down was, what'd you get? Okay, two down was? Okay, how do you, oh, you looked over here. So what is a trajectory? Okay, wait a minute, you're laughing, you say it. Yes. All right, hold on. On the count of three, say it. One, two, three.
Trajectory.
Okay, so what is it? What do you think it is?
Yeah.
What do you think it is?
Look, it's three words.
All right, Charles.
Is it a flight path?
All right, say it again.
Flight path of an object.
The flight path of an object. I need one person from each of your groups to go to a board nearby. Go to a board nearby, and you're going to show me an example of a flight path of an object. I need you to look up, and I'm going to spend about 60 seconds just kind of making sure we're on the same page. In math, it's one thing learning how to solve an equation, but it's another thing being able to apply. This year, you guys have shown me that you know how to apply the logic that you're learning. You've been able to make equations. You've been able to make word problems. So today, myself, Mr. L, and Ms. Angel decided to do something a little fun for you, and hopefully you'll like it as much as we do. So you're going to be able to link what we've learned about quadratics and parabolas to a real-world situation. Your essential question today, can someone read it for me, please? Yes! Miss Countryman is going to read nice, loud, and clear.
If Miss Hall, Miss Angel, and Mr. L jumped off the other ledge, would the trajectory of their jump form a parabola? Who would jump the farthest? I think you would.
Okay. Okay, so now just by show of hands, I would like to know the answer you think to the last part of the question. Who do you think would jump the farthest?
The youngest.
All right, I'm gonna call off the names. Mr. L, hand up high. All right, hand up so I can count. Oh, y'all think Michelle is better than me. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Okay. Miss Angel. How many of you say Miss Angel? Okay. Oh, well, yes. She has wings. Don't be hate all your life. All right, so still one person for Miss Angel. And then what about Miss Hall? Okay, good. I still have some. Okay, I got y'all. One, Gray's coming out. Three. Hold on, you can only vote. Wait a minute. No, baby. You can only vote one time. You can't vote for Mr. L and then vote for me. That's why you're booked. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, that's right. This whole. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. See, them the true lovers. Yes, I got you. Okay, we're gonna find out at the end who actually jumped the furthest. And you're going to get to X, and then you what you see you cannot do at home. So real quick through the agenda. You already did your warm up. Now it's time to play Angry Birds. But before you play Angry Birds, I have to go through the steps and teach you exactly what I'm looking for from the activity. After we're done, we're gonna talk about what you did. And then at the end, you get to figure out what really happened with the essential question. You actually have an exit slip that you're gonna do. And why do we do exit slips? Anybody, raise your hand, please. Anybody, why do we do exit slips? I need somebody in the back. All right, Miss Kimball, yes. All right, nice, loud, and clear, Miss Kimball. Why do we do exit slips?
To see what we have learned for the day.
To see what we've learned for the day. All right, great. So that means my expectation is, even when you're having fun, that you're actually learning something. So now, the last thing, you're going to get to do something, a free choice. I'm going to give you two options to choose and get to have some fun. All right, so before you can move on, and if you were looking at the board, you just saw it. Before you can move on, I need somebody to show me, or I need the first group to show me what vertex form looks like. So vertex form of a quadratic on your board, you have a marker, you have exactly 20 seconds. 20 seconds, I need to see vertex form on your boards, please. Vertex form on your board. Hey, you're a team, so that means it doesn't matter who gets up, but you need to be working together to get it. Pardon me, Mr. Price. Put that back together. I'm loving the collaboration. I'm loving the teamwork. I'm loving that I hear you talking. Does it matter if you get it wrong?
No.
All that matters is what? That you tried it. Yes. Because we'll learn how to get it right. You're learning. Show me what you remember so far. You're learning.
Plus K.
Okay.
Yeah. Now we have a solid.
Okay. No. I want everybody to look at the board, and you're going to check your answers to see if you're correct. So I need everybody to look at the board, check your answers, and see if you're correct. If you are not correct, go back and modify your answer, and then be prepared to tell me what you did wrong.
Oh, it's A?
Or what you did incorrectly.
I thought it was a negative. It's no Y equal. I'm
not going to say anything yet. This is going to be a really good question. Is there a Y equals?
Yes.
Could it be a Y equals? All right, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I'm so glad that you're thinking. I'm going to ask for just one person to tell me one thing that you did wrong or that you did incorrectly and you had to go back and fix. Hand up. All right, Miss Giles. Yes, ma'am. Can
what
you tell us?
What we did wrong, we forgot our A.
Oh, you forgot the A. So you added your A?
Yes.
All right, cool. So two things. Oh, y'all, okay, what else did you do? What did you do? Anybody, either one of you.
We forgot to square.
You forgot to square it. Very important. We can't forget to square it. This is a tried and true formula. You have to have every part of it. So I'm glad that you recognize part of learning is recognizing when you made a mistake so you can go back and change it and make sure that you get it right the next time. Now, there was a big question. The question was, is there a Y equals? Now, somewhere under here, I actually have something, and I have F of X equals my formula. So does that mean you're wrong? F of X can equal who? And you see it all the time when you have quadratic in standard form. All right, so now, here's the important question, because you're going to be working in vertex form today. I need to know some important things about this formula. So if I was to give you some information, you got to be able to tell me what's important. Yes, Rachel.
The A is important because if it's negative, then it's open down.
A little bit louder, Rachel.
The A is important because awesome. If it's negative, then it's facing down. But if it's positive, then it's facing up.
Ooh, snaps, claps, and sparkles. Okay. There's a lot of variables. Somebody tell me something else about the variables that you know. What do you know? Miss Gilbert. Nice. Loud and clear.
The y-intercept.
Louder.
The y-intercept.
What about the y-intercept? Where is it? Yes. Let me ask you something. Do you remember this? Because you're like on the right track. And sometimes we see it equal to zero, like Rachel said. You said the y-intercept. Where would the y-intercept be? Say it louder.
It'll be C in that problem if K is 2.
Okay. You sure it's going to be K?
No.
All right, say it. Okay. This is really important. I got some thinkers. They're thinking. Tadrina knows that the y-intercept is somewhere in here. She knows that the C, as she mentioned, is the y-intercept in standard form. She thinks that the K is the y-intercept in vertex form. However, Ms. Hook had a different idea. Ms. Hook, what do you think about the y-intercept when we're using vertex form? Where is it?
You'd have to solve it, and you have to put a 0 for X.
Ooh.
Because you're trying to get rid of the X so you can get the Y because it equals Y.
So you said I would substitute 0 for X, because if X is 0, then I have my y-intercept. Snaps, claps, and sprinkles. You'll get there. All right.
Oh, snap.
Now, so we got the Y. We have the y-intercept. We can find it by substituting X for 0. We know what the A represents. You didn't tell me about the H, the K, or the X. Yes. Rachel, I don't want you. All right, somebody tell me about the H and the K besides Rachel. Oh, snap! Mr. Muhammad! Yes! Okay, Mr. Muhammad, nice, loud, and clear. What do you know about the H and the K or the X?
The H and the K is the vertex, and when you solve it for the vertex, then you have to change the... if the H is negative, then you have to change it to a positive.
So we take the opposite sign of whatever the H is, but this is going to be our, what did you say, vertex? Okay. Who remembers the X? Whew. What is the X? You got to know this to be able to play the Angry Birds, I promise. There's a lot of magic that goes into this formula, but you got to know it. The X represents something. The X. Huh. Okay, it could represent, you said, the x-intercept. Intercept. Okay. So if I was to say the x-intercept over here, Mr. Sky, the ball kept falling and it fell here, that would be an x-intercept.
That's what you're talking about? Okay. Okay, so if I plug in zero for what? Plug in zero for X? Okay.
No.
Did it hit the ground at zero? Take a look. Did it hit the ground at zero?
It hit at 10.
Okay, so what would I be plugging in zero for?
The Y.
Okay, so I could get my X intercept. The reason that I'm asking you this, so everybody look. What else could I call that other than the X intercept? What could I call that? I could call it zeros, because that's the zeros. What else could I call it? It's the ball, so it's the place where the ball what?
Landed.
Did it start there, or did it landed. It landed there? All right. The reason that I asked you that, because all of those things are important. All of those things are important when you're playing the activity. So now.
You know, it's interesting, as I think about the behaviors of the kids today and their attitudes toward math, I am often reflective on where they began. You'll notice I called on a student, Rachel, and I said, you know, it's interesting. She keeps raising her hand, and in the beginning of the school year, she was so quiet and so timid, it was impossible sometimes to get her to speak. You know, it didn't happen by accident. Now, part of that is creating an environment where kids feel safe to respond, to raise their hand, whether they're right or wrong. You'll notice I asked the kids, do I care if their answer is right? And they all responded, no, it just matters if we put effort in. They didn't just make that up today. This has been what we've been talking about throughout the school year. In the beginning, I asked the students, I said, how much does effort cost? And they say free, because they know that's where we're at. That didn't happen yesterday, didn't happen last 9 weeks. This was something that was built from the beginning of the school year. The relationships and the rapport, I can joke with the kids now, was built at the beginning of the school year. We started with structure, we started with organization, we started with respect. I couldn't go past day one, week one, without building a relationship with my students, building one of trust, teaching them to understand that we respect each other in the classroom. It's not just about student and teachers, it's about students to students. You'll notice they collaborated together, they worked together, they joked together, and they received them. If somebody said a joke, then they could receive it. It wasn't about having an attitude and all those things. It is so important, especially with so much going on with our kids today, that we teach them these things. Don't expect them to always have it when they come in. We have to actually support them and be the role models to teach them how to work together, how to collaborate, and how to come into the classroom and get past the I can't. Today's problem was not easy. To some degree, for some folks, especially going in, my kids are learning. We have to remember they're always learning, and it's okay. Let's just kind of help them along and pull them along through the learning process, and don't let them give up. Our first word that we learned was not a math word. Our first word was perseverance, because I know that in math, that's the first thing that kids want to do is give up. We talked about it, what is the meaning of it. They described it, they drew pictures of it, they talked about what it takes to persevere. So every day now, I can say, okay, what's the first word we learned? And kids will tell you it's perseverance. So now, it's time for the activity. Every group is going to have a leader. So there's going to be one person, not many people, I need one leader. Hold on, I didn't tell you the rest of the roles. Hold on. Nope, I'm going to let you choose. But wait, there's more. Wait, there's more. Because I'm going to give you, Charles, hold on. You may want one of the other roles. The other three roles, or four roles, depending on how many people it is, I have two observers. The observers, may I, will have a clipboard, and on your clipboard will be an observation form. Like so. The observation form will capture all the important information that you just gave me. I'm not going to tell you what the information is. You're going to figure it out when you get to your location. So I have two observers. I also have one person who's going to be the launcher. So I didn't put their role up here, but you're going to be the launcher. Now, listen carefully about the launching. You are going to, Scott, see, you're going to get over there and you're going to know what to do. You are going to figure out how to launch your bird.
Yes, you're getting ready to launch your own Angry Bird. Now, Miss Angel, would you like to demonstrate one way that we figured out how to launch a bird? So pay attention, launchers. And what I would recommend that you do is I would recommend that you actually practice your launching first. Now, I'm going to pretend I'm the observer. And let me grab one of the boxes. Notice, while we're getting set up, notice I have yardsticks. Why do you think I have the yardsticks? Yes. Why would I want to know how far it goes up? It represents something. Oh, okay. So I could know some information. I heard starting point, the vertex. So it's going to give me some information. So I'm the observer. I'm observing. Yeah, check. Okay. Now, I'm getting old, so I didn't catch my vertex, but it's important. So somebody else caught the vertex, which is why it's important you have two people. Now, remember when I told you you can use your cell phones today? Yes. Well, the reason I said you can use your cell phone is to help the observers. So those of you with like a fifth person or your leader can take on this role can actually be recording, and you guys can play it back to actually see the recording so that you can see where your vertex was. And then also you're going to need some other information like where it landed. Okay? All right. Miss Angel, you want to try it one more time? Okay, she's going to try it one more time. And look at the device that Miss Angel is using. Okay. Now, I have rulers, I have rubber bands, I have clipboards, I have what you need, okay? It is up to you what you choose to catapult, but you have to listen. There's two important things, rules about this. It has to land on the desk. That's rule number one. That's rule number one. And then we thought about giving you guys negative numbers, although we know that we don't go in reverse. But in this instance, we're going to ask that when you start, that you start at least, your bird is at least where this ruler is ending at right here, okay? So that means you will know where your bird started and where your bird landed. Got it? Now, so if your bird starts here, if this was an axis, y-axis, x-axis, what point would that be? What point would it be? Here's my x-axis, or my y-axis. Here's my x-axis, and it starts here. And I'm just going to say that this is the beginning of the positive number line for the x. What do you say? Zero, zero, zero. Okay. So that's a hint for you so that you know where you started. You started at 0, 0. All right, so last thing, when you get your forms, your objective is to write the equation in vertex form. You're gonna do all of this to write it in vertex form. You have to do four tries, four good tries where you started in the same position, four good tries where you started in the same position, and you need to record it. We're going to take the average of that. I'm not going to calculate averages for you. That is your job, your team's job. Now, any questions before I tell you to move? No? All right. The group in the back, your group is going to be working on the far end, and Miss Angel will help you guys kind of get. All right, teams, identify who your folks are that are going to be A, your leaders. I'm going to move this out of your way so you guys can get in there. B, your observers. And then who's going to record if you have someone recording? And then last, who's going to be the launcher? Okay? So now, I'm going to start giving out birds and launching materials. I'm going to give out birds and launching materials.
All right.
Leaders, you have 12 minutes.
We have 12 minutes.
Let me just wrap it up. Turn off, okay. Ready? Yeah. Oh. Oh.
When you bite, you get
everyone should have at least one recording.
Black 23. The height 23.
Observe it. You should have at least one 35. Recording.
35.
One of the things that was really powerful and very necessary in our classrooms today is the use of technology. You'll notice in the video that our students were using cell phones, and when they used a cell phone, they weren't texting on it. We were teaching them something else to do. Instead, they were videotaping the trajectory of the birds launching. And the reason that they did that is so that they can get a better pinpoint of actually where the bird was launching. And, you know, just teaching them to use a tool to do something that actually could help them mathematically is powerful. In addition to using cell phones, the kids also were using iPads. And in this case, our iPads, we were doing a heads-up game. We were also videotaping, but we're using it in a manner where learning can happen, and learning was fun. You'll notice that I used a PowerPoint to display the work that we're doing. And even within the PowerPoint, there were other add-ins so that the students could get visuals of videos and other things that are necessary for learning. And it's not just, you know, oh, here we go today, slide one, slide two, slide three, but instead we brought the work of math to life, and we showed students that you can use technology when you're doing math. And quite frankly, I hope one of their takeaways is they can use technology when they're doing all of their learning. It is so impactful, or it's so important, I should say, that we use technology in our classrooms, because our kids, that's what they're doing right now. You've heard the buzzword, digital natives. That's who they are. That's their world. They wake up on Facebook, internet, on Twitter, Instagram, you name it. This is where they are, and we have to meet them there. If this is their learning needs and desires, then wake up. We gotta be there, and that's where I want my classroom to be, and that's what I want my class to be able to experience, that, you know what, I'm here with you, and we're gonna learn together using the technology and the tools that you know. Your goal is to launch it over. And anybody can try it. Try it again. And you might wanna pull it a little bit off. Just make sure that you have it lined up here, okay? And you wanna launch it. Okay, nah, I could've been
so looking at this one.
On this side, so somebody has to be on that side looking at it, because it's increasing on that side, it's decreasing.
We ain't doing nothing. Come on this side and look at this thing. You sure we got
the same light before?
My bad.
Hey, keep practicing until you get it.
What's your why gonna be?
I did good.
Think about it.
And I get my ruler. Thank you.
What's the why when it lands? What number is the why? You gotta. I want you to think about it. Talk to your group. I'm not gonna tell you.
Oh.
Now, when you are done, you can move back to your seats to begin doing the rest of the work. You are welcome to grab a whiteboard. You can use the boards in front to do the work so that you can solve for your A. Those of you who are at the point of solving for A. You know, if you're catching the video of this class from the middle and you see the kids flopping around birds, one may make an assumption that, whoa, wait, they're having fun in math. But if you watch a little closer and you look a little deeper, you'll notice that they're making observations of the work that they're doing. So what we've done is connected what kids would normally have on a cell phone, and they're playing the angry birds, and they're, you know, launching birds around. We've brought it to real life to say, hey, you could be somebody who's making this video game, because there's so much more that goes into it. And instead of me standing in front of the room and just talking about it, we actually brought it here for the kids to actually do it themselves, and they can be the video game expert by writing down what is the vertex, what is the landing point, and understanding what does this have to do with actually coming up with an equation to represent the situation that's going on with the Angry Birds. So now let me give you your next time limit. You have exactly the next 5 minutes to come up with your equation. Listen, to come up with your equation in vertex form. I'll be walking and listening to your questions, okay. And I'll also be asking you guys questions. Well, first things first, we're going to write what our vertex, we're going to record our vertex. And our vertex is going to have that average range, so that distance that we have, and it's going to have our height. So which number is going to go first?
The 8.
Okay. You called it the H, okay. And then which number is going second?
The K.
Okay, so now go to the bottom there. It says origin. So now the question is, well, what's the origin? Where did you begin?
0, 0.
Thank you. Think about it. X, Y.
Oh.
It's okay. Everybody did it. Next, it says, what was your ending point? So where did it land? Your average landing, where was it? Okay, so is that your average landing?
Yeah.
And then what would the coordinate of that be?
0 and this
22.5.
Okay, so is 0 going to be the x or is 22.5 going to be the x?
It's going to be the x.
Okay, so I want you to think about it. What axis did this represent? And what axis did this represent? Okay.
No,
she just
girl.
Really, really.
Oh, I keep forgetting.
So now, your goal is to write me an equation in vertex form. So I want you to think about the things that you need to write in vertex form. What variables do you have to have plugged in for it to be in vertex form? Okay, you need the H and a K and one more.
And a zero.
Do you see a zero? I said variables.
The A.
The A. Okay, so now here's the problem. Do you know the A?
No.
You know everything else.
Zero.
You can't guess it. You can't guess it. You know everything else. Unfortunately, in this case, you're going to have to solve for the A. So if you know everything else, then what can you do with all the other numbers that you know or variables that you know? Plug it in. Thank you. I'll be back.
Okay, that's you.
Yes. Okay. You're going to plug it in. So now here's my question for you. Typically, when you write me an equation in vertex form, you need three things. What are the three things that you need?
Vertex.
Your A.
Okay, so what variables? What are the variables that you're going to plug in?
Yeah, A going to be a zero.
K and H. And X.
So. And we know our A going to be a zero.
But we're solving for A.
All right, so now, when you write your final one, you're going to write it with these three things. But right now, you're right. You're solving for A because you don't have it. So, but you do have your X, your Y, you have your H, your K, so you can solve it. All right, I'm going to give you guys time to actually do that. So plug in everything that you know.
Sure.
Up there.
Okay, Miss Hall.
So let me just say this. Here's something that's going to be tough. You're solving for two variables or one? But it's an equation. Because you're solving here. So
F of X.
So it could be Y. It could be, what is the Y?
F of X.
18.
The I is... I mean, it would be 18.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, right? Because that's where it hits on the y-axis. So that was the y-intercept. So it'd be 18.
Okay.
No, A is one problem.
No.
What if A is 18?
That's
what if A is 18?
Okay. So you're guessing A, Y can't be anything. I know it's a variable. When I tell you you have everything that you need over here, I promise that you do. The only thing that you don't have is A.
Is X zero?
I don't know. Is X zero?
Oh, it's 20.
I told y'all that.
No.
Girl.
X zero.
Because that's the vertex. So if you draw it, if you draw it on a graph.
Can I? Okay, yes. Keep going, keep going. I love it. Okay, so I'm going to interrupt for just a moment. Here's why I'm going to interrupt. Because as I'm looking here, I see that we have an equation, we have two variables. What are we solving for?
A
or Y?
A.
Okay, so we have, well, hold on before you erase. It's an equation for a reason, because when we're solving the equation, we got to get something by itself, right?
Right.
So we got to get A by itself.
Right.
So that means Y is part of this equation. You got to plug in what represents the Y. So in a second, we're going to go back to the very first step to make sure that everybody has everything plugged in correctly. I just need to look at one more group and we'll do that. But you got to plug in the Y. So look at your data and determine which one of those pieces of information represents your Y. Uh-oh.
So if you grab the vertex thing,
it'd be at 20.
But they say Y is a red number.
Sorry, my graph is ugly.
Yes, we see that.
You weren't supposed to, but it's okay. Okay, so it'd be at 18, so right here, and 29. And then, so those two numbers can't be our x-intercept and our y-intercept because it's not at zero. Our x-intercept was 29.
Wait.
Put it should be 29 right there.
And our
other zero was 0.0. That doesn't make sense.
51.5.
60 seconds, and we're going to come together.
So what's the x-intercept?
It's 20.
I meant Y.
All right, I'm gonna call time in less than 60 seconds. I'm going to call time in 5 seconds. All right, I need you in 5, 4, 6, not 2. All right, one, I need everybody's attention on Miss Hall. I'm going to the front. All right, so ladies and gentlemen, listen carefully. You have done an amazing job. I need to make sure we're on the right track. At the very bottom of the page, you begin to form equations in the form that we need, so which is vertex form. Miss Hall is going to write vertex form on the board. Yes, I can write vertex form on the board. Now, you all have done a great job because you figured out that we need one missing piece of information. We need the A. Now, someone asked Ms. Hall, well, what is the X, Ms. Hall? What is the Y? I need you to notice two things. On your paper at the very bottom, you have one question or one box that says, what is the origin? Okay, origin. You too can be a math teacher. Tell me, what was the origin that I told you guys you had to start at? Okay, zero, zero. What's the X, what's the Y? Not your question. What's the X, what's the Y? Okay. We're gonna write this out using our vertex and using a point that we know is on our parabola. And we're gonna solve for A using that. You're also gonna solve for A using, what was the second point that I asked you for at the bottom? What's the second point at the bottom? The ending point. So I got my ending point. What? Somebody tell me, let's go with this group over here. Tell me what your ending point was. What was your ending point, group three? 1, 2, 3.
35.
It's just 35?
What, 26 points?
I need an order pair. What was your ending point? So I have a graph. It ended somewhere.
Oh, 35 and 26.5.
Mm, Is that possible? It ended in the air.
They don't go together.
Question yourself. Always ask yourself, if I went to the graph and I was to plot this, and I'm just going to pretend, Mr. Sampson, I'm going to pretend. My x-axis, my y-axis, my x-axis. I'm going to pretend that I'm plotting this. So you're telling me that it ended somewhere around here, 35 comma 26 or something like that. So I have, this is, did it end in the air? It landed here. So now, where was your ending point? Somebody give an example of your ending point. Group in the back. Group in the back. Mr. Snyder or Ms. Walker, what was your ending point?
22.5.
Comma who?
Zero.
Comma zero. Your ending point, it landed somewhere, which means it didn't land in the sky. So since our y-axis represented the height, it had to be at zero. So now, I'm going to use theirs. And I'm going to round it to 23, comma zero. You have two ending points, or you have a starting point and an ending point. When you substitute, you're going to substitute these values in your vertex. So now I'm going to ask a question. Since I'm using your data, Katina, tell me what your vertex was.
Oh, 23 comma 13.
So somewhere up in the air, we landed, and we were at a height of 13, we'll say inches, and then over here, it was in the middle of yours. Okay, so we got a problem. Can somebody tell me what's the problem?
We got
23.
I just underlined two 23s. Why is this a problem?
Isn't that when you start at? When you do 23?
Okay,
read. Oh, that's the end of the problem. Okay.
Yes, what's my issue here? Okay, if the vertex is in the middle, pay attention. If the vertex is in the middle and the vertex is where it splits it in half, can both points be at 23?
No.
Okay. For you and for your data, that's an easy fix. For you and your data, how can I say that that's an easy fix? How can I say it's an easy fix? If you know your ending point, what do you have to do to get your axis of symmetry? What do you have to do to get your vertex? Think about it. 60 seconds, think. If you know your ending point, how do I get that axis of symmetry? What is that point? Okay, so I know that my axis of symmetry is here, and it does represent the x value of the highest point. So I'll say my x, my y, and here's my axis of symmetry. And what's happening here? Somebody tell me, what am I doing to my parabola? I'm cutting it in half. So over here, and they told me 23, so I'm gonna write 23. Their ending point, their furthest point was 23. What can I do? If this is zero and this is 23, what's my axis of symmetry? What's that vertex?
X is 23.
But what is it? That's not the answer to the question. Okay. So I hear two people up in the front. Say it a little bit louder. One of you.
You would have to half 23.
Louder.
You'd have to divide 23 by 2 because it would be in the middle.
If I divide 23 by 2, somebody real quick. What's 23 divided by 2? 23 divided by 2. 23 divided by 2. Hurry up. You don't need a calculator. Stop. All right. 11.5. How did you do it so fast? Okay, fine. Those of you who don't do it really fast, just think, round it up to 24. You know half of 24 is 12. I promise you do. And then if you dial it back, just a half. All right, so now I have my axis of symmetry. I know my x value. You know your height. What was your height, Katina, for your vertex? I can't hear you.
13.5.
She has a point. her x and her y, she also has her vertex. Ladies and gentlemen, you have 2 minutes. 2 minutes. I need to see you plug in both of those formulas, everything you know except for the x. I need to see them on your big whiteboards or on the board. You know what? Forget about the big whiteboards. Go to the board. I need to see it on the boards. You guys, you have two boards. You have the boards in back. 2 minutes. I need to see you plug everything in. That means two people need to be at the board. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you did an awesome job. Ms. Mallory, have a seat for me, please. Let me move this out of your way. All right, here's what I want everybody to do. Whew. I want everybody to do like this. Whew. Thank you. Thank you. That's over. Listen. End it. You know we're going to end that. So now, sometimes math can take a lot of work, but I promise, Mr. Lawrence, I'm going to get you this way. Mr. Schneider, I'm going to get you this way, please. I promise the work that you put in, it benefits you so much more on the outside. Now, I'm going to ask you a few questions, and before we go any further, I do have to take a look at some of your, and I'm going to start with this one over here. And the reason I'm going to start with this one, because I think everybody started to get it at the end, how to solve for A, what to plug in, because it was confusing at first. Wait a minute, I got all these numbers, where do I begin? This group, okay, this group, hold on guys, I want everybody to turn around Charles. They actually plugged in their origin first, and then they solved using their vertex and their origin. Yeah, we're going to look at this one. Now, it's interesting because most of you found it easy to use the 0, 0, which is always easy. However, what I did not see anybody do, can we stop? Okay. However, what I didn't see anyone do was use their landing point, because it will be interesting to see if you also got a negative number. Because now, I will ask you this. Was this supposed to be negative? Is your A supposed to be negative?
Yes.
Why?
Because it's facing down.
Oh, because our parabola is facing down. If you would have got something that was positive, something would have been wrong. Now, the last thing I asked you guys to do was to write your write your equation in vertex form. I only needed three things. The three things that I needed was my A, my H, and my K. You had everything that you had everything that you needed. The reason we leave these blank is because this could be any point on my parabola, on my graph, which you found because you had your origin and you also had your landing point. Now, first question, what did you learn from the experience? You've been learning about vertex form, and it's one thing to see it, but now you're actually applying things that you've done. Imagine being the creators of Angry Birds and coming up with the different equations for each of the birds. Now there's a little bit more that goes into it, and when you get to physics you'll learn about it. But just having a learning right now puts you in a great position. What did you learn? What did you notice that was different every time that you were bouncing that bird across? What did you have to do differently? Because some of us, we struggled when we were putting when we were trying to flop the bird. It's okay, sugar, just pay attention. Why was it difficult? What did you have to change about what you were doing? What kind of aha moments did you have? Now, Miss Angel, if you can give everybody a sticky note, because I want them to take a moment to just kind of reflect. Miss Hall is going to put the reflection questions on the board. If you don't get to all the questions, we're still going to go ahead and have our conversation. Pardon me. Question. How you feel with the lights off? You want me to turn the lights on? You're comfortable? Or you need the lights on? Off? Okay, fine. I'll let you reflect in the dark. First question. Talk to me about the trajectory. What role did it play? What did you answer? And actually, I don't even want to go through the questions. Tell me what your learning was. Tell me if you reflected on a question, what did you reflect on? I'll take an answer from each of the groups and anybody can respond. Hand up though. So I gotta call somebody. All right, hold on. You don't have to start with the first question. You can answer any question you want. You know, it's just funny because when I think about over the school year, Rachel was the quietest person in the class, and now I can't get her to stop responding. So I am going to start with Rachel, and then I'll go to group number three, Ms. Giles, and then I need someone from the back and someone from the front. Rachel?
My answer is two. The x-intercept.
Okay, hold on. If you chose not to respond, then what should you be doing while someone else is talking? I'm making it real easy for you. We're quiet. And gentlemen, we're sitting up. I have two people who are not sitting up. Sit up for me, please. Thank you. Rachel?
The x-intercept shows where...
A little bit louder, Rachel.
The x-intercept shows where the quadratic starts and also where it ends.
Ooh. So in our case, we're talking about the bird. Okay. So now, Ms. Giles, you wanted to add something?
A different question.
It's okay. You can answer whatever question you want.
I
want
to do number three.
Okay. Do number three.
was it easy to launch the bird? I said no because when you launch the bird, you got to land it on the desk. It can't hit the ground or nothing.
So what did you have to do to get it to land on the desk? Because I did put a lot of rules in there. Huh?
You got to stop hitting it hard. You got to do it like gentle.
So you had to change your maneuver, your technique, to make sure that you met the requirements? Ah, very good. Okay, I have, Ms. Mallory, you have an answer? Okay, you want to add on to number three, and that's fine. You answer whatever question you want.
And you couldn't hit it from, put the bird at the top of the board and where you want to hit it at, because it wasn't going to go anywhere. You just got to put it in the end of the board and hit it at a slow pace and make it fly.
Oh, all right. I'm loving it. Now, the only group I haven't heard from is my group in the back, so I'm going to get somebody to give me a response from the back. Anybody, anybody. All right, Mr. Snyder, Mr. Lawrence, Mr. Robinson, Ms. Kimball, give me something. Any question you want. You wrote it down for a reason.
What was the shape of the trajectory? We said a curve, because it's going.
Okay. And does it have a name?
What's the name?
What's the name of that curve? Come on.
Quadratic. Oh, yeah, parabola.
All right, so and that brings us all the way back to our essential question. So who remembers what the essential question was?
Who would fall off?
Who would fall off?
I mean, who would jump off the ledge?
Okay, I'm sorry. Who would what?
Jump off the ledge the farthest.
Okay. Was there anything else on that essential question?
Oh, no.
Well, we already got answers. Yeah, we already got answers. Everybody said that Mr. L would. You want to know? Okay. So, that's excellent. All right, so it said if Ms. Hall, Ms. Angel, and Mr. L jumped off a ledge, would the trajectory of their jump form a parabola? So that was the first question. Yes, no, or maybe so. Hands up if you say yes, it would form a parabola. Okay. Next. Who would jump the furthest? I already got your responses. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to actually take a look because we actually jumped off a ledge. Now, I'm going to say, ladies and gentlemen, I promise if I see anybody standing on my desk, standing on my tables, I will. This is recorded, so I'm going to just be really nice. I will have a conversation with you. And then, so that all parents know that you are not to try this at home, although I'm pretty certain. I'm pretty certain he didn't try a lot of stuff. All right, who do we want to start with first?
L.
Okay, we're going to start with Mr. L since everybody said Mr. L. Now, what's important is you watch where he lands, because remember, this is the back of my room. Watch where he lands, okay? You need to say it again?
Yes.
All right, now you see where he's at. I'm going to go to Miss Angel next. We did not move the table. Okay. You think it's okay? Pretty close. All of you haters on Miss Angel. Okay, you ready for Miss Hall?
Miss Hall, you have on your shoes.
I had on heels.
Oh my God, I should have voted for you, man.
I'm not gonna give it away, but you could probably call me Superman's wife because Miss Hall was flying. Oh. Y'all ready?
Yep.
Jeez. I use the essential question as sometimes as a hook. Today it was used as a hook to get them to think about quadratics. Typically when we start or when we have our lessons start off with an essential question, because the essential question could go on over a period of days. It's that way to bring the kids back to what is it that we're doing? What are we focused on? And if you can answer this question, that means we were able to accomplish what we set out to do. So if the task is solving equations, and our central question is focused on getting them to demonstrate that they have that conceptual understanding, then at the end, whether it's 2 days later or even a week or two later, that if they're able to answer that essential question, that lets us know that we were able to accomplish that task. Now, today's essential question was a little more fun. Today's essential question was a little more fun than we always have. Okay, first off, I told you I had on heels. Okay, but hey, all that matters is where I ended.
Ooh.
All right, so who jumped the furthest? Look at where the computer is. Miss Angel, and only one person voted for Miss Angel. And that was Tamia. So Tamia snaps, claps, and sprinkles. All right. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you did an awesome job. So two things. Thing number one, you do have an exit slip that you're going to do. But you know what? You guys have done such an awesome job. You're going to get your exit slip. I'm going to be allowing you to have your choice of two activities. And this is just math fun for you guys. One of them, you can do heads up. And the other one, Miss Angel made some little boxes with our pictures on it. And you can choose to do Angry Birds and knock us over. And that will be the only time you get to knock us over. Let me be clear. So you get the choice of going over here, you can do your Angry Birds, or you can come stay over here and you can do heads up. And we have 8 select words, and we can see what you learned from the heads up. Miss Angel, do you have your the heads up ready?
Let me start.
Who wants to be the person for heads up? Okay, so everybody's gonna start. Okay.
I wanna start since you already know what the game is.
Okay, stand up. If you guys can get all the words, this surprise is getting more special by the moment. All right, go. You can't tell her the word. Hey, turn to the
word.
It was 8 into 7.
Yes. All right. So you got 1, 2, 3. 4. You got 4 out of the 8 words that was in there. Snaps, claps, and sprinkles. Before I let everybody get to knocking us down, we're going to give you your exit slip, and then we're going to begin wrapping up. And when you're wrapping up with the exit slip, you are more than welcome to do the Angry Birds. Give yourself a round of applause because you did such an awesome job. When I closed my lesson today, we closed with it was kind of a two-part thing, because one piece was the essential question. And although fun, it was still one of those things to get the kids still thinking about the work that we're doing, because, you know, does the shape of the jump create a parabola? And in the beginning, you made an assumption and you guessed, okay, if they jumped off a ledge, would it form a parabola? Okay, hopefully they won't jump off a ledge, but then the kids responded. And then secondly, you know, who jumped the furthest? So now we're thinking, with all the work that they've done, even though I didn't ask the question, you know, what does it take for me to jump the furthest? And, you know, and I'm thinking ahead for them. I'm thinking about physics. I'm thinking about other math that they're going to take that will rely on this information, that is getting them to think about and reflect on, oh, I remember when we did this in Ms. Hall's class. And so you remember, one of the things that I noticed that Mr. L's force and his, you know, his weight or what have you may have, because he was a little lighter than everybody else, pushed him further. And Ms. Hall was a little bit heavier, so she just plopped right off. And so as they're thinking, you know, or as I was thinking about the closing, it was a matter of, how can I get kids to, you know, in a fun way, think about the work that we've done? So that was one. We also reflect. And in the reflection, you know, the kids had to think about, and I didn't just ask them, okay, so give me your reflection. What do you think about the lesson? It was geared around specific aspects of quadratics, of the vertex. You know, so what role did the x-intercept play? You know, what, describe for me, you know, what was happening? How did you get your bird across? You know, just getting them specific targeted things to think about. And the first thing I did was tell them to write it down. Because if you don't write it down, then we're sitting there just kind of waiting for everybody to respond. But once I've actually thought about it, because I've written it down, it makes it easier. And I said it was two things. But then at the very end, since we still had a little bit more time left, we were able to go back to the vocabulary words that we started with. And this time, it was interactive. And so you had the heads-up game. And, you know, families use this at home. Why can't we use it in school? Throw some vocabulary words in. So we were able to put our vocabulary words in, start from where we began. So now the kids get to talk, describe those words. They didn't have the vocabulary sheets anymore. If you recall, I asked in the beginning of class, I said, okay, Mr. Owens, tell me what the word trajectory means. And he couldn't remember, and they had to pass him the sheet. But it, when it came up on the screen, those kids were going. When it came to axis of symmetry, so now we're creating that connection and that meaning of what the words mean, and we're doing it in a fun way. And so now if somebody goes and asks them, oh, hey, now I noticed that this bridge is here, and what would you call that point where it splits it in half? Well, the point is called a vertex, and that line is called the axis of symmetry. Now, that may not happen, but in my dreams, I think so.